Well, there was this time where in my life when juggling was the most important thing in the world to me. Like, I watched videos about juggling. I watched videos of people juggling. I practiced juggling for hours. I talked about it to everyone. I was so excited about juggling, I wanted to update people on my juggling progress, what I was juggling and how many of them and for how long and all that kind of stuff. It was exciting times, y'all. I know you're not very excited about that right now, but let me tell you this. It was amazing, and I was very, very cool at the time. Looking back, though, there are a lot of things like this in my life that I just got really excited about for, like, a time and then haven't been very excited about since that time. Like, racing dirt bikes, that was a big thing for me. I was like, I'm going to go pro, man, you know? It was also being in a band. Like, I wanted to be in a band. I wanted to be so good at playing anything, and then I realized I'm just not. There was also playing sports. Some of y'all who know me know I didn't make the sports teams. There was also drawing. I just wanted to get so good at drawing, and I put all of my energy and all of my effort into just getting so good at drawing, and then it was cooking, and then it was the next thing and the next thing. I just couldn't help but think that, like, someday, eventually, I'm gonna be famous. Like, I'm gonna be famous, the next big thing in any one of these categories, until after a little while, I kept realizing the same thing again and again. Like, I just never learned that it's just freaking hard. Like, everything is, it's just hard to be the absolute best at something. That's why there's only one. That's why I kind of self-identify, if you know me, as a jack of all trades, master of none. Maybe you've heard that phrase before. It basically just means that you're, like, kind of good at a lot of stuff, but you're not really great at anything. And I wonder if you've had anything like that, like something you got into the habit of doing and you just invested all of your time. You couldn't shut up about it. It was just the only thing you cared about. The rest of the world just didn't exist. It was all about this and just honing in your craft, developing your talent, and getting amazing at that. Because why? You are going to be a digital artist for Pixar someday. So you realize, like, dang, it's just actually really, really hard. Maybe for you, it was vlogging and, you know, you got all the equipment. You're like, I'm going to start a YouTube channel. I'm going to be famous. I'm going to go viral as heck. I'm going to be TikTok famous. Maybe you dreamed of being the next big thing in sports. I'm going to be the next LeBron James. Maybe you wanted to graduate the top of your class. And for some of y'all, that's different, okay? You're the only one in your class. I'm talking to the people with, like, multiple people in their class. But hey, no disrespect. Y'all are probably smarter than us public school kids anyway. Maybe you thought that you and Stephanie were going to be best friends forever. You got the bracelets. BFF. F. F. Only to find out relationships are hard and y'all just grew up and you grew apart, man. I don't know. Friendships fade. I know. The dreams, they fizzle. Aw. Yeah. You lose hope. You settle for less. I know. I wonder if you've ever been there with God. Yeah, no one's saying all now. I wonder if you've ever been there with God, where you were super obsessed with him. You were so in love with him. He was all you could talk about. Your pen ran out of ink because of how much you'd be underlining scriptures in your Bible. You had a promise ring on, like, all 10 fingers. It was like Jonas Brothers times 10. On all your social media accounts, it was just scripture. That's the only thing you posted. What is it now? Don't tell me. Maybe you prayed without ceasing. Maybe you slept with your Bible under your pillow. Maybe your Bible was your pillow, and just by osmosis, you felt like the Word of God, this is going to come into my heart. Well, it probably faded, didn't it? If there was a moment like that in your life, it probably kind of, like, faded a little bit. Maybe that's you as you sit here in this place. Maybe it's because you got a little bit busy. Maybe it's because life circumstances just changed. Maybe it's because you got criticized a little bit, and then you realized, dang, it's not as cool to be that Christian at school. Maybe all of the time and energy and effort that you put into your relationship with God just got replaced with the next thing. The next thing. So we fall out of love with him. But I don't know about you, I don't want to fall out of love with him. I want more and more of God. Like the song we just sang, like, I'm caught up in your presence in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Where does it take not just to get to that place in our relationship with God where that's just all we want? Like, we want nothing more than just to be in the presence of Jesus constantly. For him to just be flowing in us, through us, out of us, in everything that we think, say, or do, just all be about bringing glory and honor to God. Can we live our life like that? Not just get to that place, but live in that place and never fall out of that habit. That's what this series is all about that we're starting tonight. And I know it's difficult because God is invisible. God is invisible, right? And it's hard to not just be able to text him and then he texts back. To not just be able to FaceTime him and then you can see him and have a conversation and fall asleep on the phone together. He just isn't going to leave you on read. In fact, you might be leaving God on read. He gave you a letter. He sends you a message. Have you even opened it? Have you read it? Have you replied? If friendships fade, if friendships with people that we can see fade, how in the heck are we supposed to maintain a relationship, a friendship with a God that we can't even see? It has to do with habits. That's what we're going to be talking about for the next 5 weeks. There was this time where God himself was here in person, and you could see him, and you could ask him questions, and he would talk back because he was a person. His name was Jesus, and he walked around on planet Earth a couple of thousand years ago. And some religious leaders at this time that we're going to be looking at tonight in Mark chapter 12, if you have a Bible, just go ahead and open it up. New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, it's right there. And they were asking him a question, just like me and you want to be able to do. Well, people already done did it, and we can go and see what they said and then what Jesus said in return and learn from it. These guys were religious leaders. They were experts in the law. They knew a lot of things on paper about God, but they didn't know a whole lot about having an intimate relationship with him. So they ask him, because there were hundreds of laws at the time, yo, Jesus, if you're really God, tell me which one is the most important. Which one is the top of the list? Which one would you put at number one in like this effort to kind of trap him? And his answer was one that they probably could have guessed. It's one that you probably could guess, and you probably even know it, or you have at least heard it before. In Mark chapter 12, verse 30, Jesus' response to that question is, look, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. Like, love God with everything. Let him be the only thing you talk about, you think about, you whenever you eat, sleep, dream, whenever you go to bed, whenever you wake up, like, let it be all about God, all for God. Like, that's what it looks like to love him with all of your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength. Jesus was like, do that. Do that. The problem is that this was the what. Like, he answered the question, but he didn't tell us how. Like, everyone here probably knows that. We know that we're supposed to do that. We're like, yeah, that's easier said than done. Like, I know I'm supposed to love God with everything in me. But, like, how, though? Like, how, actually? Well, later, because we have the ability to kind of see through time and scripture, the Pharisees didn't get the answer right then, but the answer is later in the book of John, where John, who was one of Jesus' followers and one of Jesus' friends, he was there in person, he saw Jesus, he worked with him, and he knew, Jesus knew, that while this was the case, and you got me in the flesh right now, it's not always going to be the case. Like, eventually, you're not going to be able to see me anymore. And you're going to have these questions that we have today. Like, how do I have a relationship with someone that I can't even see? How am I supposed to spend time with someone who's, like, not even there? What is that going to be like? I know I'm supposed to love the Lord my God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and I can do that now, Jesus. Like, I love you. You're right here. I can give you a hug. But how am I supposed to do that when I can't? And Jesus says this in John 15:5, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain, and that's a key word, remain. Remain when it is hard, when it is difficult. Remain whenever it is inconvenient. Remain when it's uncomfortable. Remain whenever you are being criticized and rejected. Remain in me. Jesus said, if you remain in me, I'm like a vine. And you're like these branches that shoot off of it. If you remain in me and I in you, look, if you put your faith in Jesus, he's in you. It's your responsibility to remain in him. That's how relationships work. He said, if you do this, you'll bear much fruit. And they would have got this metaphor at the time because farming was like a whole thing. They knew a good tree produces good fruit. Like if you're a good person and you got a good God working on your side, then there's going to be good things that come of it in your life, around you. People will be impacted in a positive way. That's like the fruit of you, your life, if you're a branch connected to the vine of Jesus. But apart from me, he said, you can do nothing. You can't do this if you're cut off. You can't do this apart from me. You can't do this on your own. I made my own version of this passage that I'm going to share with you. It says, because we're not farmers today. I am the outlet. You are the iPhone. And I chose iPhone because we are all fearfully and wonderfully made. If you remain plugged into me, because he's the outlet, it'll be dope. Apart from me, you straight dog water, fam. You are straight dog water. I mean, if you think about it, this actually like works out really deep. Because if you could think about all of the amazing things that you can do with a phone, I mean, it is an amazing piece of technology, am I right? Like, it has access to absolutely everything, super fast computing power, it's compact, you can access, like, it's fantastic. Just like you, just like every person in here. Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Right? Yeah, I know. But you gotta remain plugged in to Jesus. He's the power source. And when you think about it, all of the influence, all of the impact, all of the love, all of the hope, all of the encouragement, everything that comes from Jesus, from the outlet, from the power source, can dwell in you and go through you just as well. And that's that fruit that I'm talking about. I like that analogy better than the vine thing, but you know what I'm saying? It works out. So what I want to ask you is tonight, are you plugged in? Are you plugged in to Jesus? Because if you're not, listen, your battery is going to die. Your battery's going to die. It's going to be like this habit that you've got right now. You're super passionate. You're all charged up about Jesus. You're just operating for him, through him, by him. Everything is good. What happens when that fades away? What happens when you fall out the habit and your battery dies? You're not about Jesus anymore. You're about something else. And in fact, you're just a paperweight. You're kind of just this dead vessel right now that could be doing amazing things, but it's not tapped into any of the potential of the power source because it's technically dead. It needs life. It needs some electricity charging up through it and in it, right? You need to be plugged in. You need a charger. That's the Holy Spirit coming from the phone to the outlet. That's the Holy Spirit. He's like the connection. He bridges the gap. Jesus is the power outlet, and God is like the Wi-Fi. He just connects everybody, like the whole world. He makes it all happen. So what does being plugged in look like? We're like, yo, if we're plugged in, that's the goal, right? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. What does it look like to be plugged in? What does it look like to remain? And I got to say, it looks like time. I'm just going to say one word. It's time. How much time are you spending plugged in? Because if you're unplugged more than you plugged in, eventually you're going to run out, right? You got to spend time. Just like with any relationship, just like with any talent and any skill and anything you want to get better at. Look, if you are a Christian, if you want to be not just a Christian, but a Christ follower and you want to live for Jesus, you got to spend a little bit of time. You got to spend some time. We're going to talk specifics about some just practical ways we can do that throughout the series. So I really hope that you're here for every week of this series. We're not going to get into it all tonight, but I just want to give you one thing to get you started, and it's kind of like a challenge coming from me, should you choose to accept it, okay? And it's simple. It's just spend, here it is, spend 10 minutes a day with God. 10 minutes. Can you give him 10 minutes? And that's going to be easy for us to say now. It might even be easy for us to do this week. But after a little while, there's going to be something else catch your eye. There's going to be an excuse that comes up. Watch for it. And you know who's throwing those things in your way? It's the enemy. You think he wants you to win? You think he wants good things to be happening in you, through you? No. You think he wants Jesus to be thriving and in control of your life? Man, heck no. Watch out for these things that try to steal your time. Because time is the key to this. So watch out for the things that try to steal your time. For me, I got to schedule the time. It's at the same time, every single day, at the same place. And if it doesn't happen, it just won't happen that day. So that's important for me. I don't know what it is for you, but just some ideas real quick. Listen to worship music. You can create a playlist that is 10 minutes long and listen to that playlist, all right? You can just find a YouTube video. I swear there's like an elevation worship song that is a whole darn 10 minutes long, one song, and you just listen to that song, all right? Let that be it, right? Maybe you can map out, use your phone, barring that it's charged, and map out like a 10-minute walk around your neighborhood, 10 minutes, and just spend that time walking, praying, thanking God, just talking to him, just thinking. Maybe it's doing the habits devotional on YouTube with some friends. It lasts you all month, and you could do that every single day with the friends, and they can kind of help hold you accountable. Getting into the habit of connecting with God daily will change your life, I promise you. It changed my life. And the bottom line for this evening is connecting with God helps us know him better. You got to do this. You got to do this. When we know him better, we love him better with all of our heart and all of our soul, all of our mind, and all of our strength.